Welcome everybody to the first year of Selenium training. Out here in this training, we have got people from all the backgrounds. Some of them are very new to Selenium, some of them they know Selenium a little bit, some of them are working on projects, and some want to clear interviews. I'll be catering to all of you in this training, and I'll be going in a very systematic manner and covering each and every aspect of Selenium. Look, the thing is, to learn Selenium, you have got three phases of learning. The first thing is that you have to learn Java, then you have to learn Selenium. By saying that learning Selenium, you have to learn WebDriver, Grid, TestNG, JUnit and Maven, Jenkins. There are lots of things. Don't be afraid of these terminologies. I'll tell you what they are. Right. And in the end, you have to learn how to build frameworks. Frameworks means basically an end-to-end project. Okay, there are various types of frameworks. We'll cover all of them. Right, but before I jump over to this training, let me take up few questions, few frequently asked questions which were being asked by many people before the training. I have noted them out and I'll just take 5 to 10 minutes of your time to discuss these questions. These will give you a lot of insight into the training and a lot of clarity in thought process. Right, now the first question is, what is Selenium? Ram was asking this question. Right, look, if you go to the official website of Selenium, which is seleniumhq.org, right, the first line says that Selenium automates browsers. Selenium is an automation testing tool which is only for web-based automation. It is not for automating your mobile apps or something. It is not for Windows-based application testing. Okay, if you think that you can automate your mobile app or you can automate your mobile browser or a desktop based client with Selenium, then you cannot. Right, for mobile you have another tool known as Appium, you can use that, but Selenium is only for web based application. Now as far as the browsers are concerned, Selenium supports all the major browsers. You can run your scripts on all these major browsers, right, but the only problem for the testers is that they have to learn one of the programming languages mentioned over here: Java, C Sharp, Python, Ruby, JavaScript. In this training, we'll be doing Selenium with Java. Okay, 70% of the industry is using Selenium with Java. Now, I have seen people becoming afraid of programming. They are not very comfortable. Look, it is something which takes a little bit of time. That's it. And moreover, if you learn the programming language in this course, and later on if you want to learn any other tool like Appium, which is for mobile automation, or you want to learn JMeter for load testing, or SOAP UI for web services testing, or even other tools like QTP, which is VB script based automation tool, or Load Runner, which requires Objective-C, then learning all these tools, it becomes really easy because you have a knack of programming with you. You have some background of programming. Okay, because the market is changing every day, new things are coming up. You have to learn new tools as well. Right. I hope you understood my point. Right. Now, moving ahead. What are the course contents? This was the second question. Look, for the course contents, you can visit our website qtpselenium.com. Over here under Selenium training section, right, if you go to the if you go to the Selenium training section on our website, you will see that there are total 44 modules, okay, all listed over here. They cover everything about Java, WebDriver, TestNG, Maven, everything is there. Even the frameworks are included, right? Modules from 18 to 25, all of them cover all types of frameworks like data driven, hybrid, keyword driven, page object model with Page Factory, Cucumber. Okay, in a nutshell, I'll just give you a little overview. These are the topics covered in all the training videos. Okay, so we cover WebDriver, we cover frameworks, Grid, okay. And we also cover about database testing, SVN, Maven. So all these things are covered. Okay. Now, if you go to the next question, right, will you cover some live projects or frameworks? Yes. Live project is basically framework, right? Out here, as I told you, from 18 to 25th module, we have covered all the frameworks. It's an end-to-end implementation on a live application. You'll learn how to generate scripts, email the reports, attach screenshots and all. Everything will be there. Okay, running on Grid. Right. Now, I want to use Selenium in your project. Can you help Well, Rashi was asking this question. Rashi, you can actually ping me after the class. We have a team which can help you out. And we also have a forum where you can post your questions, right? So that can help. And is Selenium IDE enough? This was again a question by many people, because IDE looks simple. It's a simple record and run tool. Fine, you can go to our website over here. Module 10 is on IDE. You can try to play the IDE modules. You'll realize that IDE only works on Mozilla. It generates no reports, nothing. It's a tool which is good for very small scale applications, right? And personally speaking, don't waste time on IDE. Very few interviews might ask you about IDE. When you go to any interview, they'll ask you questions on WebDriver and all that stuff. Okay, right. And if you have to learn WebDriver, you have to learn Java. And the major question which everybody asks is how much Java is required. Look, modules from 1 to 7, they cover the complete core Java which is required for Selenium. It is more than enough. Okay, 90% of the people coming to us, they don't have a background in Java. They are manual testers. This training is made for them only. Okay, you don't have to worry. Right, but don't think that you know Java and you can do it. Many people think that they know it, but they actually don't know it. Learning Selenium without having good knowledge of Java is like jumping into a river without knowing how to swim, because everything is done in Java. This is a sample JavaScript program, not JavaScript, but basically it's a script made in Java. And if I run this script, don't worry what I have written, just see the output. See, Chrome is launching and Chrome will try to go to a simple website, Gmail, and it will try to log you in. Okay, so you cannot run away from Java, but you don't have to worry that you have to learn programming. Okay, slowly things will happen. It takes a little time. It is not tough, but it is something which requires time. And you don't have to be afraid. Nothing will happen if you are afraid. You have to move ahead and learn it. Right, now I want to clear interview. I want to learn Selenium. This is the next question. Look, to learn Selenium, it will just take you 2 weeks. You go through the videos, you can learn it. But if you want to professionally learn it and you want to work on a project, and or if you want to clear interview, it will take you minimum 6 to 8 weeks. It takes time. It requires steady input of time, right? And I will be giving you a lot of videos, tutorials, practice exercises for Java, for Selenium, and that's going to help you out. Okay, how tough is Selenium? As I told you, it's very easy. It is something which is little vast, but it is very easy. It requires time, right? Okay, lot of people, they come to us. Some of them, they don't clear interviews, and lot of them, they do clear interviews. But the only thing is, people who clear interviews and who are successful are the ones who give in time, right? That's it. And if I just buy the videos, how will I clear my doubts? Yes. Look, we have got an option on our website that you can go and buy the access to our video tutorials which we are having as listed in the Selenium training section. Right. Look, you can get the access to the videos. Fine. If you have any questions, you can reach us on Skype. We also have a forum where you can post your questions. And on every Sunday, we organize a doubt clearing session as well, which you can join. And if you go by my personal opinion, then don't join the training directly. Buy the access to the videos. They are more than enough. They cover everything. Okay, whatever is covered in the training is there in the videos. People who come for the training, generally they also end up learning from the videos. But in case you want to join the training later after buying the videos, you can pay the difference amount and join the training. It helps a lot when you watch the videos and come to the training. Okay? Right, so the next thing is Java. To learn Java, the first thing is that you have to install Java. To install Java, you have to go to Google and type download JDK. You need to install JDK, which is complete Java development kit. Alright, and go to the first link which comes up. If you go to the first link, you will see the download link over here. Click on this. Okay, and on the next page, you will have the Java available for different operating systems. Based on your OS, you can download it. Most of the people, they have got Windows 64-bit, for which this is the exe. For 32-bit of Windows, this cross 86 is for 32-bit, right? Mac, Linux, anything, everything is there. Okay, you just have to accept the license agreement out here and click on the exe file. It will download. You can install it as just like any other software which is present on the net, and you install it by clicking next, 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 and you install the complete package. Once you have installed it, you can verify about Java. You can go to your C drive and you can go to program files. You'll see a Java folder. That means Java is installed, and under Java you will have the JDK folder. Alright, now once Java is installed, you need to download an editor. Okay, an editor for the for writing the Java code. Okay, for so that editor is in Java, it is known as Eclipse. Okay, like we used to have a Turbo C. Turbo C was used in C language to write the C code. Or if you know QTP, in QTP we have got VB scripting, and we have inside QTP there is an editor to write the VB code. If you don't know QTP, then it's fine. That's not a problem. Okay, look, somebody was asking me about Notepad. You can also write the Java code on Notepad. That is not a problem. But when we professionally work, when we have a big project with thousands of files and we have to execute all the test cases, right? And we have to run the project professionally, right? So over there, Notepad cannot help us. You have to use Eclipse over there. It will help you to run the project, okay, manage big projects. Alright, so first thing is you need to download Eclipse. To download Eclipse, you need to go to the official website of Eclipse, that is eclipse.org. Right, or you can go to Google and type download Eclipse. Right, you'll get the eclipse.org/downloads link. The latest version is Eclipse Neon. Okay, but don't use this. Okay, it is still a little unstable. People are facing issue. Use the stable version. Use Eclipse Luna. Right. Just go to Google and type download Eclipse Luna. Okay, Eclipse Luna is a stable version of Eclipse. And you should be using it, because later on in Eclipse, we have to install a lot of plugins like TestNG and all. Right, so please use Eclipse Luna. Go to this link and scroll down. You'll see a download section over here. Go to this section and you can download the Eclipse IDE for Java developers or Java EE developers, anything. Download the 32-bit version or the 64-bit, depending on your operating system. You can download this. Right, most of the people over here, they have got 64-bit operating system. Right, you can download from this download link. Now, if you are somehow not able to download Eclipse, then on the free videos page under this Selenium Training Day 1, this is the one, right? Selenium Training Day 1 video. Okay, over here, scroll down. At the bottom, I will be keeping a link to download Eclipse. Okay, you can download from here. Alright, now once you have downloaded Eclipse, Eclipse comes as a bundle. In my E drive under out here in my softwares, I've kept Eclipse. It comes as a zip file. You extract the zip file. You'll get this folder. Inside the folder, you will have lots of folders and files. Primarily, you are interested in this one, Eclipse application file. Okay. Look, it's not an exe which you install. It comes as a bundle. When you double click on this, you'll see Eclipse starting up, and this is a window workspace launcher which comes up. Right. Look, right now I am not telling you how to write Selenium code, how to work on project, how to build scripts, generate reports. All those things I am not jumping over to right now. What I am teaching you right now is Java, the concepts of Java, so that your roots are very strong. When you see Selenium code, or when you have to write the Selenium code, it becomes really easy and fast for you. Alright, so this is the workspace path, the path where you will be storing all the projects. Okay, I'll give my own path over here and I'll call it as, say, learning Java. So this directory learning Java would automatically be created under the path. You can also browse for a existing workspace and all from here. Okay, or you can give a new path, whatever you want. You click on OK. So this will take some time to launch. Meanwhile, it launches. There are few things which people were asking. I'll just discuss that. Somebody was asking me the question that why we need to learn JUnit or TestNG. Okay, look, if you look at the module number 8, it is the JUnit framework, and it is the module number 9, which is TestNG framework, right? Now, when we work on the Selenium project, okay, what are the requirements? The requirements are that we have to read the data from some Excel file or XML file or a text file, right? You need to generate some reports, HTML reports with the screenshots embedded in them. You need to generate some logs. What are logs? Suppose script runs for 10 hours, you need to have some file which has the information that what happened at each and every moment. Okay, right, apart from this, there are many other requirements. Just writing Selenium scripts which will run one after another or run parallelly will not solve the purpose. So we use these frameworks like TestNG, or we use the frameworks like JUnit, which help us to organize stuff, organize our scripts. Right? It is more than just running the scripts. You have to generate, or you have to make provisions of lots of other things which I just told you. Right? So we use TestNG and JUnit to organize the complete structure and build an end-to-end framework. But you cannot learn TestNG or JUnit like that. You first have to learn Java. Okay. Now meanwhile, Eclipse has opened up. This is Eclipse. Okay, don't worry about these errors. I have got mobile thing in my Eclipse, so that's why I'm getting it. You won't get these errors. Okay, so you just close this welcome screen and close the outline and the task list. So this is Eclipse. In the middle section, you will be writing the complete code, whatever Java code you write. In the Package Explorer, this is Package Explorer. In this complete window, you will be having Package Explorer or Project Explorer, you call it anything. Okay, you will be storing all the projects, and at the bottom out here you will be seeing all the logs, messages and all, everything. Okay, ignore this error and all which is coming in my Eclipse, right? That is just because of some other reason, but you will have it completely blank. Now you need to start with the project. Okay, the first thing is that you need to have JDK installed. Without installing JDK, Eclipse will not start up. If you get this kind of an error when you start up Eclipse, most of the people get this message, right? Then that means you have not installed JDK correctly. Just check out the path of JDK installation, right? Or I'll install it and install it again, right? Now you need to create a new Java project. Okay, you go to File, New, Other, right, and under Java there will be a Java section. You can see the option to create a new Java project. Okay, click on Next and give it a very decent name, like be very organized, module 1, and make sure you don't start it with some number or give a special character in the project. Keep the name alphanumeric. Fine, click on Next and finish. Right, this kind of project is associated with Java perspective. You will get this message. Ignore this. Click on No. I'll talk about perspectives later on, not right now. Okay, so this is module 1 project, under which you will see two things: source folder and JRE system library. Okay, source folder is the place where you will be storing the complete Java code, all the Java code, whatever you write, you will be stored over here. And JRE system library is something which is like Java or JDK which was installed on your machine. So it's very important to have Java installed. Right, now the next thing is that you right click on the project, you get lots of options. We'll be seeing all these options one by one. The most important option is that of the properties. This is the last one. Fine, it shows, it has got various things over here, we'll be using it. Under the resource section, which is the first one, you will see the path of the project. This, the path of the project is same as the workspace path which we had set up. Okay, if I just go till the workspace path, I will be able to see, hold on, the module 1 folder. Okay, this module 1 folder is the project name which you can relate from Eclipse. If you open this folder, you will have lots of files and folders, bin, settings, class path, project. We'll study about all of them. Dot project file means that it's an Eclipse project. If you delete this file, the project might not open well in Eclipse. Okay, so just keep all of them. Now, out of all these folders, you only see the source folder in Eclipse. The reason for that is that whatever Java code we write, we are going to write it inside the source folder. Alright, fine. And out here in Eclipse, it is empty, and in your hard drive also the source folder is empty because you have not created any Java file. So let's create one Java file. So you can right click on the source folder, click on new and new class, and I will call it as first Java program. Fine. And you click on this checkbox over here, public static void main, this one. Alright, what is this? I'll tell you. Okay, make sure that in your Java file, you don't have any number. Okay, it should not start with a number. It can be an alphanumeric name, but numbers can come in the middle or the end, but not in the beginning. Alright, so you just click on finish and you will have the Java file generated. Okay, now I'll just increase the font size in Eclipse. Okay, under Window, Preferences, under General, under Appearance, Colors and Fonts, you select the basic section, go to text font, and you will see that this option, you can select 14. Okay, so now my screen would be very clearly visible. Alright, so this is the Java file, first Java program.java, which I have made. And if you go to the location where project was lying, you will be able to see this program or the file in your hard drive as well. You can open it in a notepad. It will open up. You can also execute it from notepad, as I had told you, but we won't be doing that because it's every time we are going to use Eclipse only. Right. Now, moving ahead. Now, out here in this program, you are seeing wordings like public, you are seeing static, void. So, it must be hitting you that what these are, why they are used. Right. Everything will be clear to you. Just give me some time. In another 3 to 4 lectures, when I teach you object-oriented programming packages, so everything will be clear. You have to accept few things as they are when you start learning. Okay, now you must be thinking, what is static, why is static used, right? So everything will be clear, just accept few things as they are. Main is the basic function in which the control comes up for the first time when you run the program. Okay, right. It's a part of every programming language. If you take up C or C++ or any programming language, you will have the main function. In this function, the control comes up when you run the program for the first time. Okay, now I'll just comment it out here. Control comes here in this function. Now, look, what is a comment? It's a part of the program which is not executed. Right, comment is used by the developers to actually mark something, to tell something that, okay, fine, this piece of code is doing this thing. It will not be executed. Alright, you can write anything over here in the comments. You can write anything. Right, now when the control comes in the main function, and suppose if you want to run and execute it and you want to print something, you can give the command system.out.println. Okay. And you can write over here, print something. Right. So over here, system.out.println. this is the command to print anything in Java. It is, Java is a case sensitive language. Alright, the S has to be capital over here. Okay, when you run this program, right, if you run it, you can run it by clicking on, hold on, this small run button on the top, or the easiest way is that you can right click on your Java file and you can select the option run as Java application. So this will run, and in the console at the bottom you will see print, something will be printed. Okay, you can also click on this run button and it will execute. Alright, now as I told you, Java is a case sensitive language. S for system.out.println has to be in the uppercase. If you keep it in the lowercase, Eclipse will instantly throw an error. If you move the mouse over the error, it will give you the possible fixes as well, that there are possible 11 fixes to this. Okay, right. Moreover, at times, suppose this is the opening bracket and this is the closing bracket of this class. The scope of this class is defined by these brackets. If I by chance delete this closing bracket, you'll get an instant error that insert a bracket to complete class body. Okay, so this is the advantage of Eclipse over Notepad, right? It tells you what wrong you are doing. Right, now the command system.out.println, if there's a shortcut for it, you can just type SYSO and hit control spacebar. Okay, and it will come up. You just type SYSO and hit control spacebar. Right, like I print learning Selenium. Okay, so when I run this, it prints both the lines. Okay, now these things are not possible when you write the program in Notepad. You will not be prompted for errors, or you don't have shortcuts like these. Alright, now look, the thing is, I am not going over to very big concepts like reading data from Excel file or parameterizing the scripts, how to build a framework using TestNG, JUnit, Ajax components, Maven. I am not talking about those right now. I want to make your roots strong. If you don't know how to do simple things, how to write 1, 2, 3, you cannot just add numbers. And this is the mistake which is done by many people. As I told you earlier, they just directly try to write the Selenium code, which is wrong. Alright, now if I talk about system.out.println, everything given in this command has to be in double quotes. The strings have to be in double quotes. Numbers, you can just print it like that. I can print any number. You don't have to write it in double quotes mandatorily. So when you run it, it will print 1, 2, 3, 4. But if you are putting up strings, then you have to put double quotes over here. Otherwise, this will not work. Okay, it will give you an error. Okay, you can comment out the code by putting double slash in front of the line. Okay, now there are few concepts. Wait, for example, if I write over here, suppose system.out.println. And there is one more command known as system.out.print. There is a difference between println and print. Okay, now suppose I write over here, just be with me, system.out.println first line. Then I write over here system.out.println second line. Then I write after this third line. Okay, if I put a demarcating line between these, right, and if I run my program, you will see that first line, second line and third line will be printed. Okay, now if I put up only print over here, system.out.print, you will see that when you run it, it will ask you to save the file, fine, and it prints like this, first line, second line and third line in the same line. Look, what println does is that it prints something and moves the cursor to the next line. So when the first line is printed, immediately after that the cursor moves to the next line, and system.out.print prints in the line and keeps the cursor on the same line. So when this line is printed, After that, the cursor, it remains at this location. So when the third command line is fired, it is printed in the same line. Okay, so println will move the cursor to the new line after printing, and print will keep the cursor on the same line after printing. Alright, now there is a concept of debugging in Java as well, which makes our work really easy to detect out errors and all everything in the program. Please ignore the errors in my Eclipse. Actually, I have configured Android in my system and it is not able to find some file. Just ignore this. Right. Now, few things about Eclipse editor, which is a very useful editor. You can debug your programs. What do you mean by debug the programs? You can actually run them line by line. For example, the first thing is that I will teach you how to put breakpoints. This will be very helpful in the coming lectures. Right. You double click on in front of any line. For example, I double click in front of line number 9. So you will see a small mark over here. This is known as a breakpoint. Now what this breakpoint does, right? It will help you to actually run the program in a controlled way. I'll show you. There is a debug icon on the top of your Eclipse, this small bug icon over here, this one, right? You click on that and run it, you'll get a message that this kind of launch has to be in the debug perspective. You click on the yes button over here and you see the magic. Now over here, you'll find a green line on the line number 9. That means the execution of the program has stopped on this particular line. If you hit F6 of the keyboard, then you can run the program line by line. So if I hit F6, see that print something is printed in the console. If I hit F6 again, then learning Selenium. Right, so every time I hit F6, I can execute the program line by line. And if I hit F8, F8 means run regularly. I'll show you again, I'll run it in debug mode, the control stops here, F6 will run it line by line, and if I hit F8, it will run it as a regular program in a faster mode. Right, you can also put multiple debug breakpoints. For example, I can put the breakpoint on line number 9, and I can also put it on line number 15. Okay, and when I run it, I click on the debug icon, so control will stop on the line number 9, and if I hit F6, it will run by line by line, and if I hit F8, it will run normally and it will stop on the next breakpoint. So there were two breakpoints over here on line number 9 and 15. So if I hit F8 on line number 9, it runs regularly and stops on line number 15. Right, so this is debugging. Okay, if I can hit F8 again and run it normally. The advantage of debugging is that, suppose you are running a big project and some error is coming up, you are not knowing actually where the error is coming up. So what you do is that, you end up putting breakpoints over there and then you analyze the program. You can check the state of all your variables and all you have declared. We will see variables, data types in some time, and you get to know about debugging in more depth. Okay, if you go to the breakpoints tab, right, you will see the breakpoints, all of them, two of them are over here. You can enable or disable them from here as well. Or if you want to disable, you can double click over here in front of the breakpoints, they will be disabled. Alright, and if you want to go back to the previous view, you can switch over to the Java perspective in Eclipse. Right, in Eclipse you will see a small icon over here. Okay, you click on this icon and you move to the Java perspective. In Selenium, we always move to the Java perspective. So the current perspective is debug perspective. So you move to the Java perspective. Okay, right. So this is the normal view which we had earlier. You can normally run your program from this run icon and it will not stop on any of the breakpoints. If you run it in the debug mode, then obviously if you have put any breakpoint, it will stop on that particular breakpoint. Right, as I told you earlier, breakpoints will help us solve the programmatic errors which we make, or programmatic, you can say, hindrances which we face when we are writing the scripts in Selenium. Okay, now moving ahead, if you right click on the project and go to the properties of the project, you will find the location of your project. I told you this earlier as well. And if you open this, you will get the source folder in which you will find the program which you had written. It got updated. Now correspondingly, you will also find the bin folder. Inside the bin folder, you will find the class file corresponding to the Java file. Every Java file, when it is compiled, it is converted into a class file. This class file is similar to exe files which we have. And this class file is platform independent. Now, what do you mean by that? Platform independent? You can make this file on Windows and then you can make it run on multiple operating systems like Linux, Unix, Solaris, any operating system, Mac OS. You can transport this file to that operating system and run this file. Okay, but that system on which you are running should have Java installed, obviously. That is why Java is platform independent language, and that is why Selenium with Java is very famous. Okay, when in the coming days we will study about Selenium Grid. What is Selenium Grid? Selenium Grid helps you to run the programs parallelly. You keep one machine, I am talking about a computer, a dedicated machine, and you connect multiple machines to that machine and you run the scripts parallelly on those machines. Okay, the execution will be controlled from the central machine which is known as the hub. Okay, so what happens is that generally we keep the scenario like this. For example, this will be my Windows machine, this will be my Mac machine, this will be my Linux machine. So you can test your application or your web application on different operating systems as well by running them parallelly. And that is the advantage in Java. You just have to make your program once in any programming language, deploy the class files and all on the main system, and it will run parallelly on multiple systems. Don't get confused about it right now if you're not understanding. As we proceed, we'll see more into Grid, you'll come to know. As of now, just understand that class file is something which is platform independent. Right, and if you want to actually proceed with your career in Selenium, you have to know about these class files and all. Right, now when you are working on, say, Unix environment, you don't have any, you can say, Eclipse over there. It's a shell. Unix is a shell. So over there, when you have to execute these programs and all, you don't use Eclipse, you use something known as Ant or Maven. Okay, if you go to my website QTP Selenium, and if you go to this site in the module number 8, 9, I have talked about Maven, Ant. So those are the tools which help you to run your scripts from command prompt, and over there you will actually require these concepts of class files and all. So just giving you an overview so that when you come over to these topics, you know what exactly you are going to do. Right, now moving ahead, so let's talk about data types. Data types are there in every programming language, like integer, int, byte, char, boolean. Fine, most of you must be knowing about that. Okay, if in Java, if I write int, okay, the color becomes automatically red. Right, so whatever color is there in the red color over here, these are the predefined reserved keywords in Java. That means that these keywords or these words are a part of Java language. Okay, so int is also part of Java language. If I write int a equals to 100, then that means that there is a memory location. In that memory location you have stored 100, and the name of that memory location is a. Fine, so inside the memory location a, we have stored 100. Alright, if I just write over here system.out.println A and run this program, you will see that it will print 100. It will print the value inside the variable A. Alright, why am I telling you this? Is because I have seen many people doing the mistake. They type like this, system.out.println, in double quotes they will write A. If you write like this and if you run the program, this will not print the value inside A. This thing will print directly A. Whatever is there in the double quotes gets printed as it is. Okay, if you have to print the value of A, you have to give A without quotes. Fine. On the next line, I can also change the value of A. I can write A equals to say 200. So what will happen is that in the memory location which you had, okay, right, the memory location A will now have 200. Alright, you don't have to write over here int A equals to 200. Again, you'll get an error. You cannot have duplicate variables. Okay, once A is initialized over here, it is declared and initialized, you can again use it, right? You can change the value inside it. You just have to declare it once. Right. Now, integers, they store numbers. They cannot store decimal numbers. If I write 100.45, I'll get an error over here. Alright. Now, I'll come over to the point that how you can store decimal numbers as well. If you talk about the limit of an integer, if you store a number like this over here, for example 9999, you keep on increasing the size, eventually you will get an exception or you will get an error that it is out of the range. There is a certain range of integer in the memory. Okay, you cannot exceed that range. Alright, if you want to store a bigger number, right, then you can use long over here. I can write the data type long. Long L or long D equals to, I can put a integer which can exceed the limits of, okay, which can be bigger in size than integer. Long has got a bigger range than integer. Alright, hold on. Okay, hold on. You see that over here you have one number extra, but this one number only makes a huge difference. Okay, basically I'll tell you integer is 32 bits, right, and this is 64 bits in the memory. It is bigger. Sometimes you have to store bigger numbers, you can use long, but you cannot store decimal numbers in any of them. Okay, right. Now out here, if you want to store decimal numbers, you can use double. You can write, say, double C equals to some decimal number. That is possible. Okay, if I print the value of C, the decimal number will be printed. I can also write, say, double, or I can reinstantiate C to, say, 45. I can try to put integer as well, but if I print this, it will be printed as a decimal only, 45.0. Even if I try to put in an integer. In long or int, if I try to put a decimal, you will certainly get an error. You cannot write 200.45. Okay, so there is a little bit of difference. Fine. There is another data type known as character, char. Right, you can write char, say D equals to. In single quotes, you can give any single character. It can be a number, letter, anything. Okay, you cannot give two characters. It will throw you an error. In character, only single character can be given. Okay, so these are the four data types which you will be using a lot. There is another data type known as byte. I can write byte B equals to sum, or byte say b1 equals to some number. Okay, byte has a range which is smaller than an integer. Okay, it is very restricted. It is smaller than an integer. Okay, you cannot just grow it like, even 999 you cannot store inside it. So there are few data types over here. Okay, now you have got a very important data type known as boolean. It can only store true or false value inside it. It's the basis of if statement. It's used a lot in if statement. You can either store true or false. Let me show you with an example. Right, if I print over here system.out.println, and if I print say 100 greater than 200. This is a comparison operator which I have used. Okay, if I run this code, this is printing false. That is, It is not true, right? That 100 is not greater than 200. That is why it is printing false over here for this statement. Okay, if I write 100 or 1000 greater than 200 and run this, it will print true. Okay, so the output of any conditional operator, this is a conditional operator, comes up in Boolean form. Okay, the conditional operators are like greater than, less than, greater than equals to, or less than equals to, or double equals to. Double equals to is for comparison. You can write over here system.out.println, say 100 equal to 100. This will check whether these two values are equal to each other or not. Okay, and when you run it, it prints true that 100 is equal to 100. You can put variables instead of them as well. You can take up two integers. Say int I equals to 100 and int j equals to 200, and you can write over here I equals to j. So when you run this code, this will print false because both of them are not equal. Okay, if I make them equal, it will print true. So all comparison operators, right, will be coming handy to us when we work with Selenium as well. Right, and these form the basis of if statements. Okay, so let us look at if statements. In if statements, you use the keyword if and then you give a condition in the brackets which should evaluate to Boolean type either true or false. If I hard code true over here, right, and inside it I print system.out.println success. Whatever is there inside these curly brackets, no matter how many lines are there, if this condition is evaluating to true, then all the lines will be executing. Right. Now, if I run the program, obviously it will print success because I have hard coded true over here. But if I give another condition, for example, if I is greater than j. Now, I is storing 100, j is also storing 100. So, obviously this condition will evaluate to false because I is not greater than j, it is equal to j. If I run the code, right, so it will not print success over here. But if I give the condition that I equal to j, now this will evaluate to true, and when I run the program, it will print success. So in if condition, the evaluation should actually amount to true or false. You cannot just write if I, you will get some error because that is not evaluating to true or false. Now if the if statement is not successful, then you can bring the control onto else block. If this is not true, then do something else. You can write over here system.out.println both are not equal. Okay, so if I run this program and over here I can write both are equal. If I run my program, this will print both are equal. But if I make I and j different than each other, I can write both are not equal. I'll get this result. Right, if I want to find the greatest of I and j, you can put a condition over here that if I is greater than j, then print that I is greatest. Okay, else print j is greatest. I am not assuming both of them are equal. Okay, just printing whether I is greatest or j is greatest. So if I run the code, this will print I is greatest because obviously I is bigger. Now over here, if I write plus I, this is the concatenation operator. That means whatever is there in the double quotes will be printed as it is, and combine the value of I along with it, the memory location I. So when you run this, it will print I is greatest and it will also print the value of I. Similarly, we can concatenate the value of j as well. So when you run this, right, output will still be the same, but you will get the values. Alright, fine. Now, suppose you have got three numbers. Okay, you have got numbers like int a or int x equals to 100, int y equals to 200, and int z equals to 50. Now you want to find the, you want to write a logic with if else statements to find the greatest of x, y, and z. So the logic which you can use is that you can compare the value of x to both of them. If x is greater than both of them, then that means x is the greatest. Otherwise, in the next step, you know that x is not greater than y or z. Then you can just compare both of them in the next step. I'll implement it. It will be clear to you. You can first check that if the value of x is greater than y, and along with it, okay, there is no need to give so much space. Okay, you can just put single space. X is greater than y and x is greater than z. So ampersand, this is the concatenation operator. This wants that both the conditions should evaluate to true. If both the conditions evaluate to true, then true ended with true will be true. And the control will go inside this statement, and you can print that x is greatest. Okay, and you print the value of x. Now, if this condition is not successful, that means x is not the greatest. Either y is greatest or z is greatest. So in the else block, you can write else if, nested else if. This is known as nested else if. Else if y is greater than z, then that means y is greatest. Okay, and you print the value of y as well. Otherwise, if nothing is there, that means z is greatest. So I am not taking a scenario where all three of them are equal. Okay, for that you have to write some extra bit of code, but you know, this is just an example to explain you how nested if else can work. And if you run this, so it prints y is greatest, because obviously y is 200. If I make my z the greatest and if I run it, so it will print z is greatest. And you can also debug the programs. Okay, if you debug the program, you can put a breakpoint on this line number 50, run it in the debug mode. And the advantage of debug mode is that you have to click on the yes button over there. You have the variables section. In the variables section, you will get the value of all the variables so far which are there in your program. So before line number 50, all these variables E, B, you will be able to see the values of all these variables which we had defined. Okay, right? Now if I hit F6 of the keyboard, you will see that the variable X will also come up over here as 100. Okay, if I hit F6 again, then variable Y will come up, then variable Z. So this is very helpful thing. You can get the state of each and every variable when you are running line by line. And if you run it, see, it skips this if statement. Okay, it skips this one and it goes directly over here, prints z is greatest. Okay, so you can run, you can just hit F8 and it will run normally. Right, so this is the advantage of debugging, that you can get the state of each and every variable as well. Fine, now this was about basic data types. This was about basic if statement. Now there is something known as string as well. There is something in string. I'll write over here, say string str is equal to we are learning Java for Selenium. Okay, in string you can hold many characters together. Look, the color of the string is not same as the reddish color you have for the data types. This is because string is not a data type. String is an inbuilt class in Java which we use. Alright, it is not a data type, and there are lots of features of this class which I will be discussing, not right now because I want to cover object-oriented programming, then only I can cover string class in more detail. If you go ahead and log in into your Selenium account, Out here in video number 7, we will be discussing about string classes and functions. So, and we have right now covered the module number 1. Right now in module number 1, I am not giving exercises. Exercises will start from the module number 2. Okay, and they will continue. Right, so please watch the videos serially, don't skip any video. We'll be starting off with training module 2 now, which is loops, arrays and functions, which is out here on the page. Okay.